Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. So the things I will talk about joint works with Elisabetta Colombo, Alessandro Ghigi, and Matteo Penegini. So before starting talking about totally geodesic submanifolds of AG, let me perhaps explain that a very important class of these manifolds are the so-called Shimura or special or Shimura subvarieties of AG. I will not enter so much in the details of the theory of Shimura subvarieties of AG, but the definition of Shimura subvariety or a special subvariety of AG is defined as some are defined as Hodge law, say. So they are defined as the maximally reducible algebraic subvariety of AG on which a certain cohomology class is a Hodge class. So one example, so they are defined as Hodge loci. As I say, I will not be so precise. I will make, an example that will be the only class of Shimura subvarieties of AG I will talk about, which are the so-called PEL Shimura subvarieties, which are defined by endomorphism algebras. So let me assume that A is a principally polarized abelian variety, and consider, define D and A tensor Q. And one considers the locus Z, the set of principally polarized abelian varieties, L of AG, such that D is contained in the endomorphism algebra of B over Q. So so this is a Hodge class. The variation of Hodge structures I'm considering is clearly the variation of Hodge structures whose fiber at the point is just the first homology group of the abelian variety. And D is a Hodge class for A, and the points in Z are the ones for which D is still a Hodge class for the subvarieties here. So this is an example that we will treat later, and we'll make them explicit. But now let me, why did I gave this example? Because maybe some of the people in the audience are more accustomed to this than to the definition of totally geodesic. So, as I was saying, Shimura subvarieties are totally geodesics. With respect to a natural metric, the metric on AG, which is induced by the symmetric metric on the Ziegler space. The Ziegler space is, as you know, is the set of matrices G, which are symmetric and whose imaginary part is positive definite, but it's also a symmetric space and a Hermitian symmetric space, which is the quotient of the symplectic group SP to G R modulo the unitary group. So it carries a natural metric, and this metric induces a metric on AG. Okay, and we are talking about totally geodesic, which means that the second fundamental class totally geodesic with respect to this metric. But in the title, the thing we're interested in are totally geodesic subvarieties of AG, which are contained in the Torelli locus. So let me recall, consider the also maybe before saying this, let me just recall a more precise result by Van Monen in 98. He proved that Shimura, the Shimura subvariety, is are exactly those algebraic subvarieties over G, which are totally geodesic and have admit a CM point. CM point means a point which has complex multiplication. Recall that an abelian variety A has complex multiplication if we have a subfield in and Q of A, which is an imaginary double imaginary of degree 2, double extension of let me say this, K over K0 is 2, where K0 is K intersected R, then one wants that K over Q is 2 the dimension of A, K over K0 is K intersected and K0 is totally real. Is a totally real field. So it's an imaginary quadratic extension of a totally real field and whose degree over Q is twice the dimension of the abelian variety, okay? And so the result of Monen says that subvariety of a G is Shimura if and only if it is totally geodesic and it admits a CM point. Another thing I wanted to say is that which is known that a Shimura submanifold subvariety has a dense open subset of CM points. So I say this because there is a conjecture. This led, there is a conjecture by Coleman and Ort, which says that at least for genus, which is sufficiently high, there do not exist Shimura subvarieties of AG, which are contained in the Torelli locus. That means the image of the Torelli map. Now I'm going to recall everything. So in if this is the Torelli map, this means the Torelli locus is the closure of, so it is contained in the Torelli locus, meaning with that they are, let's say, the closure of the Torelli locus and intersect, and which intersect J from MG. So let me comment a moment this expectation. First of all, there are counterexamples I will talk about later for low genus. So G has to be at least 8 because below 8 there are counterexamples. And secondly, let me say what from a geometric point of view, one expects that the Torelli locus be very complicated. And a way of saying that is to say that it will one expects it to be curved. And a way of saying that something is not is very curved is to say that it does not contain a totally geodesic submanifold. If one thinks of surfaces in R3 or anything like this, no? And and so this is the geometric point of view. From a point of view of arithmetic, I think that the idea of Coleman was to say that at least for high genus, you don't expect to have many complex multiplication points. And so since Shimura subvarieties contain a lot of complex multiplication points, this is the expectation that at the end they made. So let me talk about totally geodesic submanifolds. So first of all, we started studying a bit this problem by studying the second fundamental form of the Torelli map. So J is the Torelli map, which associates to a curve, it's Jacobian, with the theta divisor. And and it's known that J is an immersion outside the hyperlytic locus. So here I'm talking everything as orbifolds. One could use level structures and make everything as subvarieties, but it's not very important now because we are doing then a local description. So this is an immersion outside the hyperelliptic locus. And so one, if one considers Mg naught the complement of the hyperelliptic locus, one has the tangent bundle exact sequence. One has here the normal bundle. And the second fundamental form is simply one takes, recall that two of, so if one calls this the projection, here one has a metric and a metric connection. And so one says that nabla 2 of xy is just the projection of nabla x y. Okay, this is the definition. And for our purposes, it's more convenient to consider, so the second fundamental form goes from TMG naught tensor, TMG naught to the normal bundle. This is the definition. It is symmetric because of the symmetry of the Levi-Civita connection. Okay. So this is the definition, but it's more convenient for us to use the dual of this. So let me denote by rho the dual of the second fundamental form, which then goes from the conormal bundle to this tensor product. And so if one looks at it in a point, at a point in MG naught, one recall that what is the conormal bundle? One has the exact sequence, the dual of the differential of the period map is just the multiplication map of sections. So one has the exact sequence I2 of KC in S2 of H0 of KC. And here one has the multiplication. This is the conormal, the dual of this exact sequence at the point C. Okay, and then, so this is N at the point C. And hence, at the point C, one has that row can be seen as a map from the ideal of quadris containing the canonical curve to would be this space tensor space. But since it is also symmetric, normally one writes it with values in S2 of the second symmetric power of H0 of 2kc. Okay, this is omega 1 of mg0 at the point c, and this is omega 1 of ag at the point j of c. Okay? Okay, so this is a linear map from I2 to so now we would like to we wanted to study this, and to do that we did it together with Elisabetta Colombo and Alessandro Ghigi. We studied the second fundamental form we used results obtained by Colombo, Pirola, and Tortora in 2001, and then by Colombo and myself later in 2010. We used some results obtained in these two papers to describe the second fundamental form, and in fact we gave an interpretation of the second fundamental form as a multiplication of sections. If one in fact works, instead of working on C, one works on the surface C times C, one can see that I2 of KC is actually contained in the H naught of S, KS minus 2 delta, if delta is the diagonal in S, in C times C. In fact, this is because KS is just P upper star of KC tensor Q upper star of KC. And if one considers simply the exact sequence KS minus delta, KS restricted to delta, and one takes global sections, one sees this at the level of global sections, this is just a multiplication map of sections. So the ideal is contained here, but since it is symmetric, it's actually contained, vanishes twice on the diagonal. So one can see very easily that this is contained here. And so with this interpretation, one has that the following diagram. So the first theorem. Is that one here, is this following diagram. Ks minus 2 delta, and here one has I2 of Kc. One has rho, which is written there. It goes to S2 of H naught of 2 Kc. And here one takes a multiplication by a section that I will, by a section which is in H naught of Ks, 2 delta. And so one ends in H naught of 2 Ks. Okay. And in fact, this is contained here. Okay. This is the diagram. What I'm saying that the theorem says that there exists a section, a holomorphic section of this line bundle on the surface, which has poles, so it's not holomorphic, okay, which really poles on the diagonal, such that the rho of Q, the diagram is commutative, so rho of Q can be written as Q times this section at eta hat. So the first thing, I'm not going to talk about this, I just wanted to mention it, will not describe well the this is just, is it clear, no? This is. So this is contained here, and so this is the first description, which for example gives immediately that rho is injective, a thing that we had already proven by with Elisabetta, but it was a bit more complicated. Now it's clear because it's a multiplication map. Okay, with this study of the second fundamental form, we were able to give a bound on the dimension of a totally geodesic submanifold of AG contained in the Torelli locus. So the numbers, so this is the same authors. We proved that given so let C be a smooth k-gonal curve of the genus G at least 4 and with the gonality at least 3. Let Y be a germ of a totally geodesic submanifold of AG passing through C, or more precisely to J of C, and contained, Y contained in the Jacobian locus. Okay, it's a germ problem. It's a local thing, okay? Then the dimension of Y is less or equal than, sorry, I don't remember exactly the numbers, 2G plus K minus 4. So we give a bound on the dimension of a totally geodesic submanifold, of a germ of a totally geodesic submanifold passing through a k-gonal curve in terms of the gonality. And let me, later we'll comment a little bit on this, but from this it follows immediately a bound on the dimension of a germ of a totally geodesic submanifold of AG, which only depends on the genus, since the gonality is bounded. So the point is that let Y be a germ of a totally geodesic submanifold of AG containing the J of MG, then its dimension of Y is less or equal than 5 over 2 G minus 1. This is simply, this follows immediately from theorem 2. Sorry? Yes. Yes, in the Jacobian locus, yeah. I've written it, yeah, yes, sorry, yeah. Contained in MG. Yes, it's in MG. Yes, yes, if you, and from this it follows immediately this bound simply because the gonality K is less or equal than G plus 3 over 2. If one plugs in this here, one gets the result. So this theorem 2 gives theorem 3. The point, the proof of theorem 2, sorry. Follows from the existence of certain quadrics for which we can somehow estimate the rank of the second fundamental form as a quadratic form. The biggest problem, as I was saying, no, maybe I didn't say it, is that we have a description of the second fundamental form, but this form eta hat that I called there, that I written there, is not, it's very difficult to compute. I mean, we know that it exists, that it has a definition that I haven't given, maybe later if I have time I will give it, but then it's very difficult to compute it. And so we can compute it only in a very, in some very special cases. And so the theorem 2 follows from a proposition which says that if one has, if C is a k-gonal curve of genus G, at least 4 with the gonality at least 3, there exists a quadric Q containing the canonical curve such that the rank of rho Q, rho, maybe I erased it, I recall that rho is a map from E2, of, no, it's written there. Okay, and S2 of H0 of 2KC, which is S2 of H1 of TC dual. So one can think about a quadric rho q as a quadric in the in p of h1 of pc dual, okay, and one can compute, I mean, it's a quadratic form and one can compute it, its rank, and so the rank of rho q is greater or equal than something 2g minus 2k plus 1. So with the let me just say how one gets from the proposition theorem 2. The way now it's just linear algebra, because since if one takes, so in theorem 2 one has to take a curve which is k-gonal and a germ of a totally geodesic submanifold containing passing through the curve and containing the Jacobian locus. So if one considers a vector in TC or J of C, or I mean TC of Y, then clearly, by definition of a second fundamental form, if one applies rho Q of for any quadric Q to this tensor, it vanishes because it's totally geodesic. Totally geodesic means exactly that second fundamental form of this vanishes, okay? And so since it vanishes, this means that that V, so the tangent space at the point C of Y, is an isotropic subspace for rho, for the quadric rho of Q. Okay, this is TC of Y is contained in H1 of TC, okay, which is the tangent space of the moduli space. And so, I mean, this is hydroisotropic. And then this is just linear algebra, so then one has the dimension of TC of Y is less or equal than, so 3G minus 3 minus, so I take the kernel, so minus 2G minus 2K plus 1, and then I add half of the rank. So on the remaining part, I mean, I pull away the place where it is 0, and then on the remaining part is just half the dimension because it's totally isotropic. So this one has plus 2G minus 2K plus 1 over 2, and so one gets exactly 2G plus K minus 7 over 2, so which is the bound. So from a proposition, you have the theorem. I will say two words about the proposition. The proposition, the way we construct the quadric, is that we use the gonality of the curve because the quadric is constructed using sections of L, which is the G1K, G1K, yes, and on the curve, and of K minus L. So if one takes, if one has two sections, to assume that this is this pencil, and then one has takes two sec, one has to take away the base locus, but now, I mean, I'm a bit sloppy here, but one takes two sections here, S1 and S2, linear independent, a pencil here, then one constructs a quadric, which is just x S1 times y S2 minus x S2 times y S1. This is a quadric of a rank 4 quadric, containing the canonical curve, because I mean, if you multiply it, it vanishes. And with this quadric, we are able to compute the rank of rho q, because we can we know how it behaves, the second fundamental form, on the set of Schiffer variations at the points p of the curve. And so the point here is that one takes as a basis a fiber very quickly. If one takes a general a general, sufficiently general fiber of the map phi, which is a map induced by the adjoint linear, no, sorry, by the two, the pencil, the adjoint linear system. And I assume that it has degree d. One can prove that the Schiffer variations, I'm not going now to define them, but they are tangent direction to the moduli spaces at the point on the fiber of a general, a sufficiently general point on the basis. These are linearly independent. And one, and by our previous work, we are able to compute the value of rho q on these tangent directions. And since we are able to do this, we prove that the rank of the rho q restricted to the subspace generated by this by this tangent direction is maximal. In fact, it is diagonal, the matrix, and diagonal with maximal rank. And so we can bound the rank of rho q using so the, I mean, I just wanted to say where the gonality plays a role. It plays a role in constructing certain quadrics on which we are able to make some computation. The computation then at the end is made using the second and first wall maps of certain line bundles. Okay, so this is the idea of the result on the dimension. But I mean, then more recently with Alessandro Ghigi and Matteo Penegini, we tried to do the opposite somehow. That means to construct a counterexample to the other counterexample to the Coleman-Ort conjecture, at least for low genus. In fact, as I was mentioning before, there do exist counterexample to the Coleman-Ort conjecture for low values of the genus. And this has been, so we're saying that there exist counter examples to the Coleman-Ort conjecture for G in this range. And they have the first one, they're all, they are constructed as Galois coverings of families of Galois coverings of P1. And the first one were constructed in 91 by De Jong Not, and they were cyclic covers, so they are Jacobians of families of Galois covers of P1, cyclic covers in genus I think 4 and 5, first ones. Then there were other examples by Rode in 2009, I don't find them, so it's not so important. So then by Rode in 2009, other examples, still cyclic covers, but maybe not completely sure, but maybe 6 and 7. And then by Monen in 2010, Monen gave the complete list of Shimura subvarieties occurring as families of Jacobians of cyclic covers of the line. And so he listed all of them, and he proved that they are the only ones. He gave a list of 20 families, but then, I mean, we also found out that some of them were equivalent. So at the end, I think there are a little bit less, like 14, which are different. So, but then there were some examples, some sparse examples, by Ott and Monen, which appeared in 2011. And they are still Galois covers, but non-cyclic abelian covers. Then last month, actually we made finish the computation these days, so together with Alessandro Ghigi and Matteo Penegini, we found seven new examples of Shimura varieties contained in the Jacobian locus as Jacobians of families of non-abelian Galois covers of the line. So let me explain a moment what we did. Sorry? Ah, sorry, yes. The genus, unfortunately, is still less or equal than seven. So we found them in, three in genus three, three families in genus three, two in genus four, one in genus five, and one in genus seven. But so unfortunately nothing. So we as I was saying, this was done. What we did, we gave a criterion, a sufficient criterion, for which a Galois cover of the line yields a Shimura subvariety, which is very easy. It's probably, so it's very similar to the one that the others had constructed. No, it's only that maybe it's written more for me more clearly. But so we gave a sufficient criterion condition ensuring that if one has a family of Galois covers of P1 yields the Shimura variety. And this is something like this. If G is the Galois group, the Galois group of our covering, one has clearly a representation of G, Gx on H1 of on the cohomology and also on the set of holomorphic forms. And so one has this action, and so one gets also an action of G on S2 of H0 of TKCT. Okay? So the criterion says that if the dimension of the invariance, the set of invariant points here, is equal to R minus 3, where R is the number is the dimension of the family. So R is the number of critical values of the covering. And so this is just the dimension of the family of curves we are considering. Okay. If this holds, then the family, then you have a Shimura. This is, sorry? Minus 3, because this is the R minus 3. This is the dimension. R is the number of critical values. So, I mean, the criteria is very clear somehow, because this is the reason is that this is actually the tangent space to the Pell Shimura variety I was describing, because, I mean, one has that G is, of course, contained in the endomorphism algebra of J of the Jacobians. And this space can be proven to be it's quite easy to prove that it is the tangent space to the space of the variety of, let's say, Pell G, that I was considering before. So the set of abelian varieties which admit G as a subgroup of the endomorphism algebra. Okay. And this is the dimension of the family of curves we are considering. So what we are saying is that the two families have the same dimension, and so the family of curves is actually the whole Shimura variety with this group of endomorphism. Sorry? No, it's one direction. Of course, there could be, even if I don't know Cantor example, there could be, well, in fact, Monin proved that this is a necessary and sufficient condition for the cyclic covers. So actually, all the cyclic covers are obtained exactly as the ones in which gives Shimura are exactly the ones in which this numerical equality holds. But in general, there could be, this is a bigger, the abelian, the variety here, the Shimura variety, is actually the image in AG of the fixed point locus of G on the action of G on the Ziegel space. So G is contained in X, is contained as a symplectic, one fixes a lambda, a lattice and a polarization, and one sees the Ziegel space as the complex structure with the polarization, and this is contained here, and so it acts Gx on the Ziegel space. And if one considers the fixed point locus, this is the Pell Shimura variety I was describing before. I mean, the image in AG is this, and this is the dimension of this. Okay. So in principle, this is a bigger Shimura variety, and there could be a smaller Shimura subvariety given by our curves. And so, I mean, it's not obvious that I don't know, because I didn't understand. Well, I mean, the proof is very difficult and relies on things that use characteristic P, and that I have to say I didn't understand well. In fact, what we did with Elisabetta and Alessandro, we tried to prove using the second fundamental form that this is also a necessary condition. We did not actually succeed completely, so we could exclude almost all cases, but not all of them. And we did it again in a similar way as we proved the proposition that I mentioned before. So in almost all of the cases, six that are not Shimura by the list of Monin, we could prove that the second fundamental form was not zero. But not in all cases. For example, we are not able to do a very simple case, which is a family in genus 4, I think with the group, it's a curve, Shimura curve in genus 4, with the Galois group cyclic of order 5, and there we are not able to prove that the second fundament, and we know it's not in the list of Monin, so we know it's not totally geodesic, also because in dimension, in low genus, totally geodesics and Shimura are the same. And so we know that it has not to be totally geodesic, but we can't prove it directly using the second fundamental form. Maybe using other tools it's doable. So now I wanted just to say what how we did. So we proved this this result that was more or less already known, but sorry? Yes. Yes. So how does it look? So we computed it, but it's quite complicated. So it's not clear how it looks. No, I don't think in general there is a simple way to say how it looks. So no, we did not do it. Maybe it's the thing that one should do. I don't know. I mean, what we did is just we computed it and the computer did it for us. So actually, what I was explaining is that so at least the way we did it is the following. So we considered all the possible. So the I have to say the first counter example we knew the new counter example the first that we found is just that we had good luck because I read the list of actions of genus of groups in genus 4 made by some Japanese called Kuribayashi, two of them. And they also computed all the there were two, all the actions of the group on the other representation of the group, and it was explicit representation. So I could count the invariants and see that there was at least one case in which it worked. And so then we thought maybe we can do it more systematically. And so what we did is just we studied the all the actions of groups on Riemann surfaces of genus G. So simply, one was wanted to study Galois covers of the line. We studied all the homomorphism from the set of gamma 1, gamma n, r, such that gamma e to the I is equal to 1, and the product of gamma I is equal to 1, and all the such the epimorphisms of these groups to the Galois group, and then the condition that this is just the order is exactly MI, which is the monodromy, the local monodromy at the point. So we studied all these things. So we made the magma study them. So magma made a list of all the possible action of a Galois group on a Riemann surface, and whose quotient was P1. So he computed all of this. And then still the program can compute the representation. He computes the character of the representation. So magma also computes the characters of the representation of G in so G acting on H naught of CKC, and then he does it because there are some formulas which are called the Eichler formula or Chevalier-Weyl formula, which allow you from the topological data to obtain the action, the representation of the group on the which is the holomorphic Lefschetz fixed point formula. So then you get a really combinatorial description of the action of the group on the homology, and then with the standard trick in representation theory, one has to find the multiplicity of the trivial representation on the symmetric second symmetric power, and so the magma does it, and then he just sees if these two numbers are equal or not. We made the computer work, and we could check that for G less or equal than 9, the only cases the only good cases, where good means that this is satisfied, are the ones that I cited before, are these seven families. So we did not find anything in genus 8 or 9, but since the computer, I mean, it took 1 month, we finished today the computation in genus 9, so I mean, it's really hard. So, I mean, we don't know if we can go further, but I mean, in principle, everything is written for any genus. One could compute it for any genus. Of course, to understand if the condition is also necessary, one should, the way we tried to do it, and we did it except for some cases, when the action was cyclic, is exactly to consider the action and the eigenvalues of the action on the, but when the group is cyclic, it's much easier. And so, I mean, this is more complicated. So this is what I wanted to say. Then, so maybe yes, in the end, what I was mentioning is that we also, there are some cases, and there were many cases in the list also of Monen, and in the case of Monen-Ort, in which a priori different families yield, in fact, the same locus in the moduli space, because sometimes one family has a group action, but it also admits another group action. So the group, it can happen that there's a group acting in, but there is also a bigger group which still acts in the automorphism group of C. For example, we found a lot of equivalences. So in the end, I think there are, if I remember well, there are like 14 cyclic cases, so different families actually, and then six abelian non-cyclic families, and then seven non-abelian ones. And one, I have to say that probably one of these was already found by Lu and Suo, one of these new abelian, even if they did it in a completely different way, so it's not trivial to see whether it is exactly the same. And so maybe if since I have 5 minutes, is correct? Yes. I was saying before that maybe I could explain just a little bit how this second fundamental form is form eta hat was constructed. And so the point is that the form eta hat is a section of that gives the it's written there still, that gives the second fundamental form is a section of this this line bundle. And so if one looks at it as we're using the projection map, the first projection, for example, of this, this is just P upper star of KC tensor Q upper star of KC tensor O S to delta. And so C KC tensor P lower star of C tensor S of 2 delta. And so if one looks at the section here, if one takes a point P in C, one gets a form eta P from TPC to H naught of the fiber here, which is C, KC tensor, KC of 2P. Okay, one can see it as a, and in this way, it's given like this. If one takes a local coordinate z around the point P, one takes u multiple of the local generator, then this is just lambda times 1 over z squared plus something holomorphic zeta, where C is a holomorphic, and this is one. So let me see. Let me say that this is how is it? How this? Maybe I did not explain well how this is constructed. If one takes this space, then one of course has H naught of. It has this form, but there is a more precise description. One has, of course, H naught of Kc, which is contained here. And one can associate, one can take the homology class, at least outside the pole. Okay, you can see it. But this is, since we are on a Riemann surface, this is just this. Okay? And the map, this map, let me call it, I don't know, alpha. This is injective. One can prove it. And since this is injective, and here one has a Hodge decomposition, and this is, of course, contained here, one can consider the image of this space and intersect it with H01 of C. Okay, and this is a line because this has dimension G plus 1 and this has dimension G. Okay, so if one takes the image there, which is injective and intersects with this, is a line. And so, I mean, this is a local generator in coordinate, is a local generator of this line. It's a form which is of type, okay, it's the local generator of this. I see it as a form with pole. And the point is that we chose one as the coefficient of the residue. So, I mean, if you see we did it the other way around. I mean, with Pirola, Colombo, and Tortora constructed the form using this on a curve C. What we proved is that if one takes all the points, one makes the point vary, one gets a holomorphic dependence, and so a section, a global section of this line bundle on the surface. And so, I mean, we thought at the beginning that this could be very helpful to understand better this form eta p, which we are never able to compute. But unfortunately, till now, it is it's not very very useful, except that it's a much more elegant way to see things. So I think I stop here. Yes. If you set the condition aside that it doesn't, you don't think about CM points. I don't know. I mean, how to construct explicitly? I don't know. What we hope they do not exist. I mean, so the idea was that since you think they do not exist, what we did is try. Let's assume it exists. And then its dimension should be low. But of course, our bound is not incredibly good because, I mean, no. In fact, the conjecture ortho, I think it's not exactly a conjecture, but the expectation is that even only totally geodesic, they do not exist. So, I mean, yeah. And I think, so there have been, sorry, I forgot to mention that. Many people worked on these problems. From the point of view of the geometry, differential geometry, there have been some works about by Toledo some years ago in which he computed the curve. In some cases, he could bound the curvature and say it's not much. If it exists, it's not very curved. But I don't remember exactly the result. But maybe the most important result is by Richard Hain that proved that one has is in 98 also, I think. Yes, that he proved that if one has a totally geodesic submanifold, which is the quotient, which is a locally symmetric space contained, or let's say gamma, an arithmetic subgroup containing the Jacobian locus. And then he put some hypothesis on the group also some other hypothesis, I mean, under plus some conditions, which are not so, I mean, there are conditions, so not for all. He gave some condition under which, for example, that if it does not intersect the bound, he gives a condition on the dimension of the intersection of this with the boundary, or with the reducible, not simple, I mean, with the boundary of MG, okay? The boundary of the closure of MG in AG, so the, I mean, plus some conditions, then he proved that G is the ball. So there are, first of all, there are some conditions to put on the group, and they are not so obviously verified. And then, secondly, he cannot exclude the quotients of the ball, of the unit ball. So I mean, but this is a very nice result in the direction to say that there should not exist so many totally geodesic submanifolds containing the Torelli locus. As far as I know, from a geometric point of view, is there are a lot of other works by Fivek, Tsuo, Lu, and Monen, and many other people, Fabrizio Andreatta, etc., that studied more the arithmetic side of the problem. Yes, this is the definition. I mean, the definition of totally geodesic is that the second fundamental form vanishes. Yeah. Sorry? Yes, from theorem one. Yes, exactly. Yes. No, I mean, I think there was a conjecture that they should not exist. Then there were these counterexamples, so they thought at least for high genus they should not exist. Now, they, at least in the last paper I've seen in the book of handbook of moduli by Ort and Monen, I think they cite it as an expectation and not anymore as a conjecture. So I don't know. I mean, in fact, we were trying to do it also for higher values of genus, but because at least it's not clear why 7 should be the right genus where you should, I mean, I don't think there are any geometric reason why 7 should be the right. Yes, this is clear also that we found, but I mean, so I think the good expectation is that they are very rare. If they exist, there should not exist so many, but I don't know, I mean, if. Ce ne abbiamo vari, lo sono scritti tutti perché pensavo qualcuno magari me lo chiede. Aspetta, sì, no, non c'è.